Simon & Schuster Audio presents Machinehood by S.B. Divya. Read by Inés del Castillo and Deepti Gupta.
Chapter 1. Welga. 30. All forms of intelligence have the right to exist without persecution or slavery. 31. No form of intelligence may own another. 32. If the local governance does not act in accordance with these rights, it is the right of an intelligence to act by any means necessary to secure them. The Machinehood Manifesto, March 20, 2095. Welga stared at coffee the color of mud and contemplated the irony of the word smart. Near the end of her daily morning run, she always stopped for a cup of joe or espresso or kahwa, depending on the part of the world, which happened to be Chennai, India, on this particular day. "I asked for it black," she said. The boxy aluminum vendor bot replied from its speaker, "Yes, this is black coffee." A microdrone flew close to her face. She swatted it away. Her own swarm of tiny cameras stayed at a polite distance above her head. "It has milk in it." "Yes, very little milk. This is black coffee." She repressed the urge to kick the machine. What kind of idiot had designed this bot's coffee-making ability? Welga glanced up at the microcameras and said, "It's my 35th birthday, and I can't get a decent cup of coffee from this piece of shit." Her fan base wasn't celebrity size, and most of them lived on the other side of the world, but someone could be watching. Maybe they'd recommend a better vendor for tomorrow's coffee. Swarms had been present in public spaces since her childhood, and she mostly ignored them as a part of life, but she wouldn't mind a little extra attention on her birthday. Between that and the day's high-profile client, her tip jar ought to do well. A voice called out from across the street, "Madam, come to my stall. I'll serve you correctly." Welga turned. A gray-haired person stood behind a folding table and beckoned with their right hand, plastic bangles reflecting the cloud-diluted sun. Metal pots sat atop basic burners around them. Plastic sheets wrapped the stall on three sides, and a fourth provided a sagging roof. After two auto trucks and a trike crammed with too many people drove by, Welga crossed the road. The vendor handed her a static cup filled with liquid as black as their pupils. Welga took an appreciative sip. "That bot has a Zimdo way. It's not meant to serve foreigners." They pronounced the acronym for weak artificial intelligence like Y, the way most of the world did. Many of the people back home said way, demonstrating the ongoing American disregard for everyone else. "How can you tell I'm not Indian?" Welga asked. The mix of Russian and Mexican in her parentage usually made it hard for people to guess her origins. The vendor tapped their temple with their middle finger. "I have a real brain. I pay attention." They lifted their chin toward the competition across the street. "That bot sees your brown skin and dark hair and thinks you're from Chennai. I see your nose and cheek shape. No gold jewelry, no puttu." They gestured to their brow. "So you must be foreign. Buts. Wise." They made a spitting sound. "They work faster, but human is smarter." Welga hid a smile behind her cub. Some jobs still belonged exclusively to people, but much of the world's workforce did little more than babysit bots while they did the real work. Artificial intelligences had dominated the labor force for decades. They had their limitations, though, like interpreting the meaning of black coffee. "What are you cooking?" she asked the vendor.
"Vegetable sambar, tomato rasam, basmati rice. But it's not ready. Come back in 1 hour and I will give you delicious food."
"Good cooking takes time," Welga agreed. She drained the rest of the coffee and returned the cup. "How much?" "No charge." The vendor smiled, revealing teeth stained red from chewing betel nut.
"Wish you a happy birthday."
Welga laughed. "You do pay attention. I like that." She pressed her hands together the Indian way. "Thank you." As she jogged toward the congested main road, she sub-vocalized to her personal Y-based agent. "Porque, tip that vendor with double the average local cost for a cup of coffee. And add them to my list of possible slow fast food contributors." A second later, her agent replied, "Transaction complete." It sounded as if she stood beside Welga. In reality, the audio came from microscopic implants in Welga's ear. The first version of Porqué had run on a palm-sized device that Welga got when she was 17 years old. At the time, the name she gave her agent had provided some juvenile giggles. Still did sometimes, though not today. Welga's mood turned sour as she finished her early morning run back to the hotel. Sweat and dust covered her body. Not a bad one at her age. She could still pass the MARSOC entrance physical. She knew because she did the workout at least once a week. And yet, her contract with Platinum Shield Services ended in 3 months. They wouldn't renew. They cared as much or more about youth and looks as fitness, and 35 qualified as middle-aged by their accounting. She could take a desk job like her boss, Ahmed Hassan, and organize the field teams, but sitting around in an office had never been her style. Instead, she'd been squirreling away money for the previous 5 years. Platinum paid well, and they provided that rarity of modern life, steady employment. It saved her from having to hustle for gigs like her father and brother. Her public tip jar stayed full too, thanks to the high-profile nature of shield work. Her plan for life, part two, was to take her passion for cooking and turn it into a business. She dreamed of funding a group of chefs who designed recipes intended to take time. Modern kitchens cooked fast for the owner's convenience, but the best food took hours to develop complex, rich flavors, like her personal favorite, mango mole. Her chefs would improve their ability to compete with kitchens by speeding up their motions and stamina with pills. She would change the world by revolutionizing the way people cooked and ate. Or she would lose everything and have to start over. It wouldn't be the first time that had happened. Gray clouds hung over the towering hives of humanity on either side of the street. Flats, as they called apartments in this part of the world, though the skyscrapers were anything but. The hotel, in contrast, had a classic colonial style. White columns and marble stairs led into the lobby. Welga sighed as the cool, climate-controlled interior surrounded her. The turf floor gave her steps an extra spring. Jasmine and other flowers she couldn't name trailed from hanging pots, their scents forming a heady perfume. Her room sat on the fifth floor and looked over a sprawling network of swimming pools. A kitchen unit lined one wall opposite the bed. Her team's client, Briella Jackson, one of the biggest pill funders in the world, could handle the expense. If only Welga weren't training her replacement, this would have been a fun, easy assignment. Instead, Platinum had stuck her with babysitting some basic named J.D. Amanuel. The new recruit had arrived the previous night, but she hadn't met them yet. She stepped into the shower and scanned the feeds in her visual field. Connor Choit, her partner in more ways than one, stood guard outside their client's door, white leathers against pale skin. Her father's feed showed him accompanying a type of bot she didn't recognize, no doubt on their way to some gig. Her brother, sister-in-law, and niece were in their Chennai flat, toward the coastal edge of the city. Those feeds came from cameras embedded in the walls rather than the ubiquitous micro-drones. Local Indian culture preferred modesty and kept swarms out of the home. Welga shrank the views of her loved ones with her left hand as she scrubbed her back. She expanded the top-ranking news video. A minderbot named Mojo interacted with a round-cheeked little boy. Its charge was a minuscule force of intellect, zooming from one question to the next. The bot kept up with him and answered everything. It had no face, wheels in place of legs, and its arms existed only to remove small children from trouble. But the voice that issued from its speaker held a warm human tone of affection and exasperation. "World's first emergent AI," blared the caption, followed by, "Is it real?" Of course not. Another fake, an illusion perpetrated by some machine rights group to advance their cause. See this nurturing, understanding minder. See how human-like it is in its interactions with this child. The age of weak artificial intelligence is at an end. Wise and bots are equal to people. They would pick the most innocent-seeming machine they could find to illustrate their point. But a recording meant nothing. Who'd corroborated it? Who had designed and funded the bot? As Welga watched, the video's reliability rating trended down, marked by curators whose own expert ratings had been verified. Another video replaced it in the top position. Welga flicked the news stream away, annoyed by the 2 minutes she had wasted on it. She scanned the latest clothing designs as she dried her hair. Briella Jackson had impeccable fashion sense and expected no less from anyone who stood beside her. Welga couldn't afford the best, so she settled for a mid-level outfit from a designer in Peru. It ought to earn its cost in tips, at least. Black leggings, red miniskirt, a jacket with glowing pinstripes. Thigh-high black boots completed it. While her basic tunic and pants remade themselves, Welga grabbed her makeup bottle, For Kay, let's go dramatic today.
Would you like the most popular choice or the most recent?
Recent.
Porquet would filter the options for her facial structure, skin tone, and budget.
What would a sentient AI do?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.